and honor this place in respect for the Dakota and Ojibwe nations of Minnesota. Next, next Thursday is a special event. It's part of the IAS Northrop University Honors Program 1968-69 series, and we will be upstairs in the Best Buy Theater, so 3:30 Thursday afternoon, but upstairs in Best Buy. And our speakers next week are retired federal judge Nancy Gertner and Alicia Brooks, who is the outreach director of the Southern Poverty Law Center, talking about American justice. So I encourage you to come and bring your friends. I want to thank, because I am sometimes bad about forgetting this, I want to thank the Departments of German, Nordic, Slavic, and Dutch, the Institute of the Department of History, the Institute of Child Development, and the Immigration History Research Center for co-sponsoring today's event. I'm really happy to introduce Julie DeGraffenried, who is Associate Professor of History at Baylor University. So she's coming here from the warm lands. And her research focuses primarily on Soviet children's history and the history of childhood, in particular Soviet childhood and children's culture during World War II. We were really eager to have her here at the IAS because she loves interdisciplinary and multifaceted approaches. That is part of what really constitutes the field of childhood studies and history of childhood. Among her publications, which some of you may know, is her book, Sacrificing Childhood, Children in the Soviet State in the Great Patriotic War, which came out with the University Press of Kansas and won the 2015 Guittard Book Award for Historical Scholarship. She's working on a new project that explores the intersection of Soviet childhood and anti-religious pro-atheism policies in the Soviet Union. But today, she's talking about war.
But that image can have a variety of meanings attached to it by a number of different players, right? It has lots of layers of meaning. So what I want to do today is to share with you a historical example of this complicated relationship based on children's experiences in the Soviet Union in World War II, or as they called it, the Great Patriotic War. The images, or some of the images, not all of them, that would be impossible, some images that detail this kind of wartime trauma, and then the uses of those experiences by public authorities during and after the war. Okay, so some caveats and some agreements right off the top. Number one, by child, I'm thinking here of young people approximately 14 years in number. Okay, so that's sort of the image. There are some particular reasons during the war for this that have to do with labor laws and youth organization sort of age cutoffs and draft age and that sort of thing. But 14 and younger is what I'm envisioning. Number two, let's say out loud that there was not one childhood experience in the Soviet Union during the war. There were many, many childhood experiences, right, that varied based on all sorts of things: location, family position, nationality, age, gender, social position, parents' occupation, right? So there's a lot of factors. And so when I talk about the hardships, I'm talking about typically faced, right? So could generally be faced by children with the very clear acknowledgement that some children experienced few of them and some children faced far, far worse experiences, okay? Number three, some of the images could be disturbing. They were meant to be, and we can talk about why that is. And four, this is a lot of hedging, right? Historians hedge. That's how we qualify everything we do, right? Number four, the word trauma was not used at the time to talk about children's trauma, right? I am not a psychologist. I have no qualms about using this word very unmedically in its sort of general sense of trauma meaning a deeply disturbing experience, right, or an event. Of course, it has a specific meaning in psychology, but Soviet psychologists at the time did not utilize the concept of trauma, primarily because mental health issues were treated strictly as biological, right? They were not psychosocial. It's part of the ideology. To give you a little bit of context, and I apologize if I'm telling you things you already know, but this is just so we're all on the same page. The Soviet part of World War II ran from mid-1941 to mid-1945. It began with the June 1941 invasion by Nazi Germany and its Axis allies on the Eastern Front, which of course is actually the Western Front when you're speaking from the Soviet point of view. For three more years, until June 1944, the Soviets bore the brunt of the Continental War against Germany as Hitler sought to expand the empire. Ideology, of course, is key as Germans poured into Soviet territory. Ideology is key because the policies followed, right? And so any policies towards, or even attitudes towards communists or Slavs or Jews, right, meant that specific groups of people were targets. Approximately 1.4 million kilometers of territory in what is today Belarus, Ukraine, Western Russia, Eastern Poland, was occupied by the Germans for about 2.5-3 years. It's hard. I should have put this. You should never say when you do a presentation, "I should have put this picture in," because you should have. Right? But I don't know if you've ever seen an overlay of occupied territory on, for example, the United States, and so you can get a sense of how much territory we're talking about. I mean, basically, think the Midwest. Like the entire Midwest, from north to south, right, occupied by enemy troops. It's huge, huge piece of territory. Only about a fifth of the population was evacuated, leaving about 85 million people in occupied territory. That's out of a total estimated population of 196 million. So 85 million in occupied territory. Atrocities began against the Jewish population almost immediately, in fact, immediately, not almost anything. And over a million people total were deported as forced labor, and tens of thousands of towns and villages and farms were destroyed. Having said that, many more millions of kilometers of Soviet territory were not occupied, by the enemy. But the population there felt the effects of the war keenly as well, right? Because of evacuation and refugee resettlement, as Natalie's been talking about, because of food policies, because of draft and troop movement, right, throughout the Soviet Union, because of labor laws and labor needs, right, which changed people's jobs, because of military requisitioning of buildings or animals or equipment or personnel, cultural policies, and so on, right? That the command economy and the governing authorities sort of swung that ship of state very quickly to address the pressing needs of a war that had quite literally come home, right, in a very real way. Tarzara points out in her book that a commentator from the 1940s called World War II a war against children. To be a child in this war anywhere was to be in peril, but to be a Soviet child during this war, in this place, in this time, was particularly perilous, given the proximity to sustained combat and to occupation. I'm going to give you a little description here of children suffering to underscore what is perhaps an obvious, but I think important point, that the hardship of children that we're going to see in the images is not made up, right? It's not something they had to go out and exaggerate, right? Because it was happening. So in sort of broad strokes, just to give you a sense of what kinds of things children there experienced. So physically, Soviet children experienced violence and bodily harm due to enemy action, right, or military action. Keep in mind that on the Eastern Front, large-scale public shootings are much more common than putting people in camps, right, or ghettos, although those things happened as well. There's injury from air raids, fire, artillery, physical and sexual abuse, or harassment, particularly in occupied territory. Children face kidnapping and detention, right? Again, particularly if you're in occupied territory, we know that children as young as 10 were taken as labor into German territories. Many children face homelessness. That's fairly typical, in part because homes were sometimes requisitioned by the military, also because villages were torched, and so there was no more home. Evacuated children oftentimes arrived to the place they'd been evacuated to, and there wasn't a home, right, like there was supposed to be. There's also the issue of hunger, right, and starvation and disease, which all sort of go hand in hand. If you're in occupied territory, the people governing you have no obligation to feed you, right? There is no obligation to feed the population that's in occupied territory. If you were living in blockaded Leningrad, right, to the north, the issue of hunger there and disease is especially acute. We know, for example, that long-term studies suggest that siege survivors probably lost 2 years off their life expectancy because of the effects of the blockade and just not enough food and all that goes along with it. Evacuation could cause problems with food supply and disease. A particularly bad example of this, August 1941, 2,700 children are put on a train to take them out of Leningrad, right, which is about to be encircled, and to take them to Omsk, which would be in the rear. That's a trip that should have taken 3 days normally, right, but nothing's normal because the war is happening. So that trip took 6 weeks. So people put those kids on a train with 3 days worth of food, and the trip took 6 weeks, right? But there's a doctor that's assigned to them who gets to the station and just says, I have hepatitis, I've got jaundice, I've got lice infestation, I've got measles, I've got severe malnutrition. These kids are more dead than they are alive, right? And there's a memoirist that talks about this particular trip who talks about going to sleep with the living and waking up with the dead, right? I mean, it was horrific. But shortages of food were everywhere. I mean, the whole country is feeling this, right? And children themselves are on the low end of the ration system. And the thing about being a kid, right, is that adults often could supplement their rations with things to trade, right? They had stuff. And what children were often in a difficult position in this situation is that they just didn't have the things that were needed to trade for food. And if you read memoirs of the war, one of the things that keeps coming up over and over and over again, right, is they talk about just being hungry, right? Perpetual sense of hunger. Psychologically, again, broad strokes, children experienced what contemporary Soviet psychologists at the time called reactive states, not trauma, reactive states, right, due to their conditions. And these could be seeing death, seeing violence, right, seeing the enemy for the first time, seeing a gun, you know, a person shot for the first time, or for the 67th time, just being afraid of attack, right, not being sure whether that was once or sort of long term. When you put, you know, that kind of weight in combination with malnutrition and disease, right, then you have the potential for a lot of problems. And so this particular psychologist in Moscow, you know, starts sort of listing all of these things that are presenting themselves, enuresis, insomnia, apathy, involuntary eye movement, vomiting. I mean, it's the complete gamut of everything your body can do to react to badness, these children are doing, right, in some form or another. These are most common for children in immediate proximity, but death is not hidden from children in this war, right? And the idea of death, the experience of death, father or brother, neighbor, teacher, this is something that is shared across the country. And the idea about sort of keeping kids from hearing these things or experiencing these things is not part of what's going on in this war. They're hearing stories about kids, right, on the front who were, you know, having a normal school day, and then these bad people came in and, you know, bombed the school, and now the kids are all dead. That psychologists tell us that if kids, a kid's sense of security is deeply shaken if they hear about bad things happening to someone who does something they normally do, right? So if they can put themselves in the shoes of, you know, someone who was just sitting at school and then something bad happened, right? There's a real shaking of security there. Kids also certainly dealt with the issue of helplessness. This comes up a lot in the language that children are using. They're not old enough to fight, right? They don't feel old enough to necessarily make choices, although they are making choices, but they feel like they can't make choices, and yet they're being asked to deal with things that are very adult-like, right? The jobs they're being asked to do, the weight of death, right, and having to think about mortality is a very adult thing to have to do. There's a lot of really good work going on right now. Psychologist Marina Gulina is working with siege survivors. So these would be people who were children at the time of the Siege of Leningrad, who she's been working with actually over quite a long period of time to get them to talk about their experiences, right? It's very clear that those experiences, I mean, they survived, right? Are still part of who they are, right? I mean, they still are affecting everything, all the way that they function in life. So it's really fascinating and heartbreaking, actually, to read. All of this is compounded. It gets worse. No, it's not a joke. All of this is compounded by what I like to think of as the orphaning of Soviet children, both literally and figuratively. Okay, so add to all of those things we just talked about the fact that a lot of them had fathers at the front, right, or at work on sort of a continuous basis, which could be sort of the same effect. Moms, too, often gone. Again, if they are in a factory job, that's often a sleep at the factory kind of job. And so whether or not you see your mom for a while is really kind of a question. Evacuation often happens separately from parents, right? And so that would cause you to be sort of orphaned, even if your parents were alive. But there's also this breakdown of supervisory institutions so the institutions that would normally be watching the kids, right? Those things are breaking down as well. Schools are still functioning, for example, but they're functioning in very odd and very sort of disjointed ways, right? The schedule is disrupted. Sometimes there's not a teacher. Sometimes supplies, so we're just not gonna have school. It's very disruptive. The flip side of that, I guess you could say, is that kids have a lot of independence and freedom. The figurative orphaning of Soviet children, I argue, comes about because of a paternal state, right? A state that has set itself up as the caretaker of children, right? The provider of this happy childhood really fails them in this war in a lot of ways. There were evacuation plans that considered prioritizing getting children out and then took them off the list, right? There are rationing plans that didn't have any prenatal care or consideration for the nutritional needs of children built in. The Soviets are discounting research on vitamins and food technology that might have addressed some of these things, right? They're just not interested in this at the time. Children's homes, yes, they're provided, but they're often overwhelmed and undersupplied and understaffed. A legal system, right, that tries 14-year-olds as adults, and this is from the pre-war period, but it flows into the war. It tries 12 to 14-year-olds as adults for things like theft. What are you stealing during a war? Right, when you're stealing food. Yeah, exactly. There's a huge street children problem during the war that's addressed not with, you know, sort of palliative measures, but with punitive measures. I mean, sort of the usual turn to punishment. I say all this, right? We might assume that that individual retellings of atrocities against children might have been manufactured. When you work with the Soviet evidence, right? There's always this kind of filter, right? You're reading the evidence going, did this really happen? Mm-hmm. Right? Did it really happen this way? You feel like you're always having to sort of read between the lines of what you're being told in any official document. And so we might question, gosh, was this particular account manufactured, right? But, well, and people who share their memories of the war, right? Memories we know can be affected, they can be changed. You might hear somebody else's story, and 10 years later, it's part of your story, and, you know, how do we separate those things? But the issue is that the evidence tells me, right, that any created account, even if we say, gosh, they made this up, it's probably based on something that happened, right? It happened to someone somewhere. There's just enough documentary evidence to suggest that, I mean, all of these things were happening to kids. And the nature of the war, right, and its attendant privations, meant that the children, even children sort of out of the reach of the enemy, right, they have to confront the trauma of death, whether it's dealing with their own family, right, or community, as well as they're learning to deal with conditions that could cause their own death, right? They're having to figure out sort of how to negotiate these things. So I think they meet the bar in terms of, you know, did they experience some kind of trauma? The answer is yes. Yes, they did. Children lay at the heart of Soviet legitimacy for decades before 1941. Even when the German invasion had sort of fixed the issue of legitimacy very firmly on the successful defense and prosecution of the war, children's bodies remained a really important element of this discourse, right? Does this state deserve to rule or not? Children's bodies are highly visible in visual and textual propaganda for adults and in the narrative propaganda for children. And really, the Soviets have no rival when it comes to World War II belligerents in its sort of graphic use of children's bodies to express state goals. And so we're going to look at some examples here of official images, meaning sanctioned by the state, right? So paid for or approved by, it went through the machinery of the state. And we'll look at some that feature damaged or endangered children. We could talk equally about textual narratives here. In fact, the textual narratives in some way are more graphic and more detailed. But when you have an audience, it's a lot more fun to put some things on the screen because it gives you something to look at. And some of these I'm going to go through kind of quickly. So if you want to go back later and sort of unpack something, that's great. I'll slow down on a couple of them, but mostly I just want you to see there's not just one, right? Wow, a whole lecture on one image. Okay, no, I didn't do that. Okay, so images of child victims could be found forms of official state messaging. Here, for example, are two examples from the stencils that were made by the TASS, this sort of news service, right, that went out very quickly to lots of different places across the country. They'd be posted in the windows, this huge sort of hand-colored stencils of images across the Soviet Union. Or in the artwork that was published, things like this we think of as posters, and they were published as posters, all three of these were, but they also would find their way into newspapers, right? These would be like the, you know, the illustration in a newspaper, or frontline pamphlets, agitation booklets that were found at the front, journals, right, often published poster art as like illustrations. They run the duration of the war, right? So I've shown you a 41, a 42, a 43. Here is a couple from 1944. Sometimes children are paired with their mothers. You saw that in the other screen. The mother is also a useful image, right, for several reasons. But there are a lot of times, right, as in these particular two examples, where the child is utterly alone, right, or seems to be alone and threatened. Death is always, at least in the threatened posters, right, if not present, sort of imminent, right? Like it happened on the right, it's about to happen, or we think it's about to happen on the left. It's a horrible Hitler, isn't it? Mm-hmm. It's a creepy Hitler, right? Not that there's a good Hitler, but that's a particularly creepy one. All right, the most famous, should never say things like that, edit that out. Okay. The most famous of the images, I think, that features a child in danger, and it's certainly one of the iconic posters of the war for the Soviet Union, is Viktor Koretsky's Red Army Soldier Save This, right? It's awesome. The use of mixed media. So Koretsky was really into using both photography and, well, a lot of different things, chalk, crayon, gouache, and so lots of mixed media. But particularly like mixing photography with those things, right, to make this sort of, this image, it almost feels like a film still, right? I mean, it's kind of black and white image, almost like he's sort of taken a traumatic moment out of one of the newsreels, right, that people were watching, you know, sort of news from the front, you know, this just in, you know, that kind of, it's got that kind of immediate kind of urgency to it. This poster was nicknamed the Soldier's Madonna. Right, it very clearly evokes icons of the mother and child, right? Mother holding the baby, Christ child. You'll notice that, I mean, what's at the center of the picture? That bayonet, which, by the way, clearly labeled. That's very important, right? Clearly labeled bayonet. It's pointing right at the wrist, right, of that little Christ child. That's not a Christ child, right? That's anybody's child, right? That's what's important. But this pair is not going to save you. This pair needs saving, right? There's a reversing of roles that's going on here. They're both clearly, you know, gazing into the face of the person that's about to do bad things to them, right? She looks a little angry. He just looks terrified, right? And again, he's really, I mean, he's very much at the center, right, of what's about to happen. In that picture, he's got a little, I don't know if you can see it, he's got a little tear running down his face. Red was used in icons to suggest things that were sacred. And of course, red has an association too with leftist movements, communism. Here, it's serving a dual purpose, right? There's a negative and a positive going on here. Negatively, right, it highlights the cruelty of his enemy and his evil intent. This pair is threatened, not yet harmed, and yet that bayonet is already bloody, right? This is an enemy that's not, you know, just playing, right? This enemy is already experienced in death, already has previous victims, right? Blood on his hands. On a positive side, right, the words in the poster, right, really jump out at you because they're red. The appeal to the Red Army stands out really brightly, sort of amid those shadows that kind of envelop them. This was published in Pravda, August of 1942. Eric exactly 24 hours for this to get through the censorship process, which is astonishing. I mean, he turned it in, it was approved, it was in the newspaper the next day. I mean, it was that sort of powerful, right, of an image. It was translated into dozens of languages so that all of the troops that served in the Red Army could read it. And it was printed, they estimate 10 million times, right? And this is, I mean, just an extraordinary number during the war, right? You can see here a postcard that uses the image, right? So, I mean, they're writing back and forth using this image. It's really amazing. Here you can see the poster. A little bit, you can see that they changed it from time to time, right? Here you can tell if they changed the color of the printing. But this one's in Leningrad, right? So, another place that's from. This is Victor Ivanov's and Ola Budova's Death to Child Killers. Death to Child Killers is actually a very common title for posters during the war. And here they're going to try and sort of answer this question or address this question, what kind of an enemy are we fighting here? Center of the picture, this deceased girl, dressed all in white, white hair bow, white dress, white flowers to underscore her innocence. She is exquisitely beautiful. Ivanov, actually, this is one of his trademarks in his posters. I mean, he's got just beautiful faces on figures. But if you look really carefully, her face is marred, right? It's bloody. It's got dirt on it. Maybe it's gunpowder, right? I don't know. But there's something off here. There are daisies that surround her. Right? You can see here, almost like a funeral bier already, right? But you know, what was she doing? Well, she was engaging in that most gendered girl activity of gathering daisies, right? Doing something completely childlike and innocent when she was caught, right? She's got some in her hand, actually not very naturally, but sort of suggests that she was caught. She lies on her back, and her arms are sort of outstretched as if in supplication, right? Maybe she said, please don't, right? Before something bad happened to her. It's nearly akin to a crucifixion pose. It's close, it's not quite. How is the killer pictured? Identified only by a boot. It's all you need, isn't it? Right? Here is this overly large. If you sit with it for a while, you realize just how big that boot is. Right? I mean, it's oversized. It's overly large, swastika inscribed, blood-stained, hobnailed jackboot, right? That appears to have just, of all things, trampled her arm, right? I mean, there's really no pulling punches here, right? I mean, this is graphic. This is the lowest of the low, right? I mean, how bad can you be? You can be this bad. This is what we're fighting, right? You can be this bad. Karetsky did the poster just before this, Spasi. He does his own version of this poster, so I'll show that to you. So you'll notice a lot of the same imagery, right? Not quite the same positioning, the perspective is a little bit different, but girl in white, she's got, instead of daisies, a doll. The bloodstained footprints, the boot, again, is just the identifier here, right? Again, deferring to Erica Wolf, you know, she says, when you look at this, because Karetsky uses photography, it's as if you're witnessing a crime, right? You were just watching through the window when this happened, right? How bad is this enemy? That's how bad this enemy is, right? That's extreme. Though often aimed at troops, and in fact, those last three were aimed at troops, very specifically, probably for obvious reasons. Audiences for these posters could vary. For example, this is a 1943 poster that you'll notice uses the same image, but the text is different, right? So the one on the left, the larger poster is intended for the rear, and so the text here is enjoining viewers to defense work, that's going to help the victory, help to destroy Germans that do these sorts of things to children, right? And then the right, what you see is the smaller poster, which was meant for frontline consumption, calling on soldiers to save children like these, right, from you know, this horrible German robber, or thief, who takes the food right out of their mouths. And as you can see here, right, you can see a couple of photographs that document the use of these images, again, images of traumatized children, in places that are not the front lines. Right? Although, I guess you could call them the front lines. Ooh, sort of, okay. This is Leningrad again, but then this is in the far in the rear, the tank factory. Just a few more, and I did not give you the images here. Film uses these images as well. It's going to utilize victimized children images. In Frederick Erler's She Defends the Motherland, 1943, again, a canonical film of the war. If you're going to watch a war film, this is the film that you watch. The protagonist, her son, is taken, snatched up by a one-eyed German invader who has come into the village. Her son is shot and then run over with a tank, right? And this happens at minute 13 in the movie, right? And it's what drives the action, right? I mean, she's already been widowed, and now she's lost her son, right? And it particularly heinous way, right? And this is what sort of drives her, right, for the rest of the film. So it's the rising action. Compilations of short films. There's a lot of this going on during the war. They're making these little 5-minute or 10-minute or 15-minute films, and then putting them together in digests. So there's a number of these. These are all available, by the way, very widely in the cyberspace. War Film Digest number 12 particularly features children. In fact, it opens with a montage of photographic evidence of Nazi slaughter in different places on what would be their Western Front, so Kiev, Odessa, Rostov, a couple of other places. And then it sort of goes right to Kerch, right, in Ukraine, and it recounts the story of parents, and again, under occupation, who were told, send your kids to school, right? You have to send your kids to school, they'll be fine. And then, of course, later, they find their children are all dead in a ditch, right, and they've all been shot. And this is in the film, right? I mean, they show the aftermath of what happened there. The film which most pointedly uses children is actually the film that's on the top. This is Mark Dunsoy's Rainbow, Radhika. And he uses children in really interesting ways, right? In his film, children are truth tellers. A lot of times they say the things that everybody's thinking, but nobody says it because they know enough not to say it, but little kids don't, right? So they just come out with it. They also, he lets them grieve on film, which is very interesting. You see kids feeling really helpless, I mean, frustrated because they just can't do anything about all the bad things that are happening around them. You see them showing amazing acts of courage, and he features, he's actually really interested, I think, in child's face and child's perspective. He does a ton of just full-on face shots, right, where you're just, all you're getting is that kid actor's reaction to something that just happened. And again, like we've been talking about, I mean, there are awful scenes in this movie. One child is shot in the back because he is sneaking a piece of bread to a prisoner, right, courageous act repaid with death. And it's a horrible death scene. In another, the Soviets, a plane has dropped a bunch of pamphlets, and so the kids go out and try and gather them, because it's like money falling out of the sky, but, you know, just paper. And the Germans just start firing into the crowd, right? The worst one, by far, is there's a woman who's being interrogated, and the German interrogator takes her baby and shoots the baby, right? I mean, it's just, it's horrible. Right? I mean, it's just horrible. they've finally been saved. And so you know, you see all these terrible things happen to children and sort of through children, and then you get to see sort of resolution or some sort of resolution. So during the war, the use of such brutal images, and these are brutal, had a primary purpose, not a sole purpose, but a primary purpose, and that is to incite viewers to action, right, on behalf of the Soviet Union in this, what was a desperate conflict. We know at the beginning of the war, there was a downplaying of ideology, right, and a sort of upplaying, that's not a word, but I just made it up, what we might call patriotism, right, sense of place, our people, right, defending our people. She defends the motherland, right? And so really this is part of it, this is an element of that, right? Troops are being fed images of traumatized children in an effort to keep their motivation and their goal clear, right? They might not have fought for X, Y, and Z. They might not have fought for Stalin, although many did, right? They might not have fought for the preservation of the Soviet Union. They would fight for their children, right? Or for little brother, little sister. This is a clear goal. In this sense, right, deceased, abused, threatened children's bodies, they become catalysts for vengeance. Vengeance for the past and defense against future heinous acts. And further, I'd argue they serve to distract from the state's own failures to protect its children. Right? There's a very clear enemy here that's pointed out. They also serve to unite, right? There are many, many peoples fighting on behalf of the Soviet Union. This is a universal language, right? The child in danger is something everybody can respond to. You don't even have to be able to read the words to understand the image. We could also note that the use of a sort of generic suffering child could also be used to de-emphasize the intense suffering of particular groups of children, right? I mean, this is a sadder use, but instead of talking about the fact that Jewish children in particular are being targeted, well, let's just subsume it into it's really sad that all kids, right, are being killed, which it is. Right? I mean, you can't argue with that. And the victim image here is actually going to elide the actual material contributions of children to this war effort, right? And this is a single sort of image of the child as a victim. And so this is going to be sort of one-dimensional in that sense. Now, there's a risk using this image, right? There's a risk. If you throw up, don't throw up. If you if you put out images of damaged children, right, or threatened children, that could be interpreted as a vulnerable future for your nation, right? And you could be interpreting this as, what do they think is happening to us, right? It could be interpreted as unfulfilled promises. It could be interpreted as loss of legitimacy, right? So this is where I think the very clear association between children's trauma and the enemy comes in here, right? As well as the choice to show such direct violence, right? I mean, I think that what they're having to, there's a recognition that they're having to overcome multiple interpretations of what they're about to show. And so to make it really clear, right, to make sure that everybody understands, I know you might not like this system, but you're gonna hate that enemy much worse, right? That we're gonna show it to you as bad as it can get. What they're trying to do is leave little room for alternate readings, right, of images like this. And I think that's part of the plan. And it appears to have worked. Troops wrote to artists, particularly Koretsky, writing about the soldier's Madonna, right, this one, claiming that it inspired them to fight harder, right, for the small children. In fact, one guy says, you're not going to believe this, but actually when we fire, we go, for the small children. I don't know if Kretzky believed it or not, but he said that. There's another memoirist who was in the Red Army who recalls a screening of The Rainbow. And he says, there's this undertow of rage that built up as that film went on, right? And particularly that scene with the baby, right? He mentions this, right? He says, when that film was over, we didn't applaud. We couldn't. It was silent. And he says, hate was suffocating us. and the audiences for which this image was intended. As I've already argued elsewhere, so I won't go into it, in the Soviet Union, that suffering child narrative was not only for adults, it was also for children. Right? They saw this, they heard these stories as well. In the post-war and post-Soviet years, literally hundreds of monuments have been erected to commemorate the Great Patriotic War. Hundreds. It's hard to wrap your mind around how enormous this event is, right? For collective sort of memory, nationhood, right? In today's Russia. Very few are solely dedicated to the war children, like collectively to the children of war. But those that do tend to draw on this childhood lost sort of image from the war. So let me show you a couple of examples. So 1975, this is outside of what was then Leningrad, today St. Petersburg. Tanya Savacheva's diary. This is sort of the, I hate to call it this, the Russian Anne Frank. I don't know, what other famous diary do we have from World War II? It's a diary of a girl who was in the blockade, right? It's really only a few pages of it that are famous. What she's doing, though, is she's documenting her family members that are dying. And the very last page says, and now there's only time left. Right? And so you sort of, as page by page, you're seeing her lose her aunt, an uncle, mother, and so on. And so this was made into a memorial, and it's raised up on a hill, right? Almost like it's on a burial mound. Okay? She herself dies at age 14 of tuberculosis in 1944. The dedication, though, says, in the name of life and against war for the children, the young heroes of Leningrad, 1941-44. In Lipetsk, Russia, this monument is titled, on the left, is titled Vital Flowers. This one is interesting. It actually replaces a 1972 monument, which was much bigger. I actually gave you two pictures so you could kind of tell the size here. This was a monument put up in 72 on the 50th anniversary of the Pioneer Organization to honor pioneer heroes of the war. And if you look for individual kid hero monuments, you'll find quite a few. Those are kind of all over the place, dotted around. But I'm talking here about collective sort of, the children of the war. So this one started to fall down and they demolished it and they put this up in 96. It's quite a small monument made out of bronze, boy and a girl holding flowers, and it's dedicated to children, all the children who died during the Great Patriotic War. Here's a 2005 memorial. So this would be the 60th anniversary of 1945. This is outside of Novgorod. This is kind of a dual site memorial. The site affects children specifically. There was a train full of children that were parked at this particular train station. The Germans came in, they bombed the train, all the children died. Right? It's one of those awful stories that happened during the war. But the memorial, even though it's at that particular site, isn't really just for those children, it's for all the children, right? Very specifically. And there's sort of a cemetery part of it, where you can see the little child in the coat, and those sort of stylized, actually, it's 2005, it was very Soviet to me, the sort of rays of glory. You see that a lot on posters of Lenin and that sort of thing on the left. And then this other memorial, which is right next to the train, or close to the train station, of the young girl. And this one, to me, looks very religious, actually. Again, she's got her feet together again. Right? I mean, again, it's a crucifixion figure. Right? Your feet are on top of each other. That's not a natural pose. There's something going on there. She's looking upward, right? This idea of, she's already been translated, to a better place. This one, again, dedication to all children killed in 1941-1945. And then there is this in Krasnoyarsk, also 2005. It was first discussed as a memorial just to the children of Leningrad, which is fascinating because it's 2,000 miles from Leningrad. And then they decided, well, no, it doesn't need to be the children of Leningrad, let's just make it to the children of the war. Okay, so it's redefined, right, a hardships faced by all children. You can see the little girl and the little boy. They are very Leningrad looking, though. I mean, like the old photographs, you see them all sort of huddled up. He's actually carrying one of those little tin aluminum cans that they would go and get the water out of the river with. But again, the intent for all kids. No longer needing to motivate viewers to action, right? So we're in the post-war period. Post-war examples have different uses for children's wartime trauma. The ultimate victory and the great patriotic war legitimized the Soviet state in a way that previous events, including the October Revolution, had not. It resulted in a new foundation myth for the Soviet regime, and of course by myth here I don't mean like, you know, Zeus did something to someone, bad things happened. But myth in the sense of an explanatory device, right? Something that gives legitimacy and identity. This myth was used by successive regimes to celebrate the People's War, right? That's very Khrushchev sounding, that saved Europe. This is what you hear, particularly in the Brezhnev era, right? We saved Europe. May I remind you? We saved Europe. So that would be an idea that's particularly important in the context of the Cold War. The war myth was and remains so powerful and flexible that it survived and even grew after the fall of the Soviet Union. So it wasn't dependent upon the ideology at all. A number of scholars have written about the ways in which Putin, right, Vladimir Putin, has used the war myth to legitimize the contemporary Russian state, and as Elizabeth Wood has argued, his own personal authority to rule. The shared suffering of the people is so revered that historian Ivan Kurila has called respect for the sacrifices of World War II, quote, probably the only social glue to form a single society in today's Russia. Meaning it's the only thing that everybody agrees on, right? Sacrifices in World War II are sacred. So the post-war period was characterized by narratives of heroic children whose deaths were interpreted as part of that sacrifice, guaranteeing them, right, sort of a place and an identity within the nation. And these monuments, I think, reflect children's shared role in redemptive suffering for the victory in the Great Patriotic War, and a message, thinking of this later, a message that could be completely supported by the veterans, right, who were thinking of this as their good war against the Nazis, right? This is a very safe, we can all agree on this, right? Saving children was a good thing. This role perhaps brought to the fore when the children themselves assumed positions of influence. You notice these don't show up until later, right? So that's kind of interesting. Although here, then you have that sort of tension of are memorials like this, are they covering for kids that didn't suffer so much, you know, that were far away in Siberia? Are they distracting from kids that suffered much, much more on the other side of the country? You know, I mean, so there's, you know, some evening out that happens that is difficult to think about. The war children are in their late 70s and 80s today, and as veterans become fewer and fewer in today's Russia, then the war children are the last group in post-Soviet societies to authentically connect the war experience to the war myth, right? They're the last ones who, you know, sort of can say they were there. So in terms of personal meaning, right, I mean, the flowers, we don't see them here. That's kind of sad. I should back up and show you one with flowers. But there's flowers on these memorials. When you see pictures of them, you could just Google them on the internet. That's suggesting that people are using this for grief, right, or education. Right, taking their children to put a flower down, talk about what happened, reflection maybe. But when we're talking about public meaning, then we have to take into consideration lots of other things, right? There's been a very fraught discussion about veterans' entitlements and who was a war participant, right? What categories do people fall into? Mark Ely has written about this a lot, as well as a very complicated discourse on the proper way to memorialize anything. Lisa Kirschenbaum has written about this as regards to Leningrad. So, speaking of complex, let me end with a twist and a story and a question. Okay? All right, so here's the twist. Think of all the memorials we've just seen. This is the 2013 Children of War Memorial that was opened in St. Petersburg. This is by Vladimir Schlepp. Notice to ourselves what seems different. One of these things, not like the other. Okay, just say something. All right, so the story goes like this. There's a competition that's launched in 2013. to the one before this. Wonder if it looked a little bit like that. So this was selected by a committee of public and private figures. The International Association of Blockade Survivors Social Organization intervened and said, we don't like that one. We don't like this artist. So they dismissed Khrunichev. They threw out his concept. They selected a new artist, so that's Schlett, and they handed him the photograph of a losing entry and said, the losing entry, I think, had four happy children on it. And they said, here, make something like this. And this is what he came up with, right? So Schlett's sculpture, it's actually on two different blocks. It's kind of hard to see in this angle. Was dedicated about 5 years ago with great fanfare, lots of flowers, lots of emotion. The dedication says, to those the war deprived of childhood, who together with their fathers and grandfathers fought and worked for the sake of the great victory. And Schlett says it depicts five children rushing into the street to celebrate Victory Day. So here's my question. Is it possible that Soviet children's trauma in World War II has reached the limits of its usefulness in today's Russia? Thank you.
Okay, the floor is open. You can choose to answer the last question first, or you can ask a question.
Representation. I was fascinated by the way you identify the religious imagery in the Soviet era, monuments and posters and so forth. I'm just wondering if you could say a bit more about that. I work in Italian film, and these representations are echoed, especially films about the war, like Rossellini, who trained and traumatized children immediately after the war. Constantly uses references to religious iconography. And I'm fascinated to find it here in the Soviet stuff. Do you think the roots of that are so deep that that spoke to people, or was it something you weren't meant to notice?
Yeah, so there's a whole set of rules that you'll know this, but icon painting, icon writing, actually, it's not called painting, right? Icon writing. has a really set sort of, it's got rules to it, right? Colors mean something, hand gestures mean something, direction of gaze means something. So there's all this meaning that's sort of built in over hundreds of years when people look at, these particular figures. And I think I know Kretzky says he's doing this. He's using something that people will sort of still be familiar with. And that's fascinating, by 1940, considering the anti-religious campaigns, right? But the idea of the mother and child, Madonna and child, right, is just so, it's still so present, right? Even if the churches have been torn down, people still have these in their homes, right? That they recognize the power of it. Of course, during the war, Stalin relaxes censorship on the churches, right? Because everything is needed to prosecute the war, I wonder if that made it a little more permissible to make something so obvious. But of course, Kretzky could have gotten away with saying, "Oh, I don't know what you're talking about. Nothing to see here." That stuff in 2005 that shows, I think, the religious imagery, that I think would be more a reflection of what's happening now, right? With sort of contemporary, I don't know if resurgence of the church is the right word, but sure, resurgence.
Super interesting, lots to talk about. I think I'll just ask two questions. One of them was regarding that one section where you were talking about that one film, She Defends the Motherland. It occurred to me, as even before that, I was actually asking myself the question of whether mothers ever, or women, ever appear actually in military, because I'm thinking about, again, the status of women and all of the comparisons that were made before, during, and after the war about women occurred to me that all you show are mothers, and even that film image, which is called She Defends the Motherland, she's not, like, obviously doing that in any armed way. So I was wondering about whether that's the only image of women that appears in any of these times and places. And then the second question is a little different, but it also occurred to me that, I didn't know you were going to take us all the way up to the present, and that's really fascinating. That's interesting, but I also was wondering about just before that. So do we have kids being used during the pact period? I mean, what happens to the images of the child when we're friends with Germany? Is that not an issue? Is it not there?
That's a great question. So let me go to the first one first, the first question. So mothers, women, in fact, in She Defends Motherland, she is going to take up arms against the Germans. She's going to fight. There are some other films where that happens. Now, it's very downplayed, and I would say, in terms of messaging for children, the fact that there are a million women in combat, you'd never know, right? Individual examples occasionally, but super gendered discussion of, you know, the men do the fighting, the women do other things. They might be working, they might be tending babies, they might be whatever, but they're not fighting. But they are fighting,
yeah.
Right? And her defense of the motherland, I think, is okay because it's this mother bear kind of thing, right?
Right.
You've taken everything from me.
Yeah.
You can't have this. You know, there's nothing left to hold me back. Tell me the period you're thinking about again.
Well, I was just thinking of, right, you know, the Soviet pact, you know, just before the invasion, and there's like their friendship. So it's a war going on, but the Germans are not combative.
Yeah, I don't remember seeing that same imagery. I think this all really erupts at the moment of the war. I was trying to think if I can think of any winter war examples. But I don't even think there. And that's, you know, in a sense, it's a little bit of a test drive for what's going to come next.
And it's also interesting because so many of the images that so much feature that, like, that German stereotype. So
yeah.
I was just thinking it's not about war in general or about, it seems to be this particular
yeah.
thing.
Yeah, absolutely. It's very specific. Yeah.
Other people first.
So one of the earlier posters that you showed was using the word cannibal.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, was that a frequent occurrence in the kind of anti-German poster printing business?
They call them every name in the book. Every name in the book.
But it seems like
cannibal
and children have
yes.
like a slightly higher level.
Elevated, yeah. I mean,
yeah,
child killer and cannibal might be like equally sort of loaded language. They're very creative with their list of things to call Germans. None of them are very nice at all. You know, beasts and wolves and rabid dogs and, you know, things that eat you. Cannibals is actually, I would say, rarer. It's not a usual word to see, but it's not unusual to see it either. One of the things that I studied in sort of looking at this in terms of, you know, what are children hearing? What kind of language are they using with children? As I looked at a lot of radio programs for kids that were on during the war, and they're equally, these are all the same words they're using towards for children, you know, to tell the stories about what the Germans are doing to people. You know, so, you know, stand up for the country and fight those fascist Hitlerite thugs who are murdering their grandmothers.
So it's not rooted in like a real case of, I don't know, cannibalism.
That's a good question. I don't think so. I don't know it.
these are re-traumatizing, and it's so bleak. So it's like the all of this cultural machinery is reiterating the trauma that people are experiencing. And I'm wondering, once it does that change over time, is there a point in the war at which that sense of needing to unify and clarify the enemy, unify the nation, clarify the enemy, is sort of deemed to have succeeded enough that people need some relief? And I'm just curious about that.
Isn't it fascinating that it goes all the way through 44?
Yeah.
To me, that's really striking. That, I mean, even that late in the war, and I mean, if I remember right, the one on the left is actually late in 44, published late in 44. So, I mean, war's over in 45.
Well, the war is just showing money out there, too.
Yeah. So that to me is amazing. I lost my train of thought. Because I'm leaving. No, it's okay. I wanted to.
No relief,
that's what it was. It is also about 44 that you will start to see troops holding kids. Because what they're showing you are liberation posters.
Mm-hmm.
Yay! Right? As the Red Army sweeps through and pushes out the Germans, right? Look, we got to save this kid. And as you get into 44, then you can't find these at all, which makes sense, I think. And you see lots and lots of soldiers holding up children with the remarkable fact that they're all whole.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you've just fed me this for 4 years. But when the victory comes, everybody's whole, including the soldier that's holding the child, right? Everybody's whole-bodied and healthy, and the child is plump, right, and smiling, because everything's back to the way it should be, right? So it's more about sort of conveying, and what you said, and it's more about conveying, okay, everything's bright again, so now we can be happy. But it's really discounting what's left at home, and the mess, right? The mess that's left in the wake of the war. But that's kind of a propaganda to us, right?
Can I speculate on the 2013 memorial?
Yes.
So maybe it's not that childhood trauma has outlived its usefulness so much as it becomes.
Sorry!
See, we go for relief.
Or relief to the winter, I'm right.
But more the idea that now it's a dangerous reminder, the kind of, you know, the war is not healthy for children and other living things. If you're prosecuting internal wars, you don't want to remind people of that war is traumatizing to children.
Hmm. I mean, I was thinking wondering too about the theories, because you talk about how the psychological theories, I mean, that's also interesting comparatively. It's not just about how it was, you know, recirculated and all, but the idea that it was okay to do that, and, you know, that children could be exposed to all this. But what you showed us different genres over time, so I'm not sure how to compare it across the genres.
Yeah.
But for example, so I was wondering, first of all, are there films that continue after the war that do show that, re-show it? But also, is the theory about it, does trauma, when and if trauma appears in Soviet and or Russian psychological discourse and analysis, and if it does, then doesn't that change the story? And then I keep thinking, of course, the transmission of trauma across generations, all these kind of theories that affect what people do in Europe and elsewhere. Is that changing? Is the story of what Soviet and Russian psychology says?
Yeah, I mean, that would be really interesting. I posed a question with a lot of answers in my head. I actually had not even thought of the psychology angle. It is changing, right? I mean, the introduction of what I guess we would call accepted Western psychology enters in the 1990s, right?
Okay.
And there's a full psychology faculty now at all the major universities, and they all pretty much ascribe to the same, but they're doing a lot of catch-up,
mm-hmm.
right? And so that's interesting, and it makes me wonder, I mean, is there a connection between that and this? I don't know. It's a great question. There are films, and any of you that are familiar with these more than I am, hear what he hears for a good part of the film, which is.
And he's behind the lines.
And he's behind the lines and he's caught. And that's 1985. And so there would have been a little relaxation with Gorbachev and being able to talk about the war that way, which is interesting. But again, using the kids' experience to do it is safer probably than using a troop soldier's experience to do it. Mm-hmm. You can all agree either.
I'd just like to say that I think images very much like this appear in early Soviet film. If you even think of like the most famous thing, the Odessa Steps scene in Potemkin by Eisenstein, you see, for example, the dead child's hand crushed by a soldier's boot. You have the mother facing the oncoming soldiers with her dead or dying child. In her hands, you see, well, the imperiled baby carriage, which is so
iconic, right?
Yeah, so iconic. But I think that early Soviet film uses many of these same tropes. So I was asking you about the religious significance, but also they're drawing on a history of these tropes that is a Soviet history of them, maybe.
This looks very Soviet to me. It strikes me as very triumphalist, in a sense. Not that they wouldn't be happy on Victory Day, but is that really the shape they'd be in? Is this the condition they'd be in? The two boys are both in military costume. You notice this? So they set up these cadet schools for, they were supposed to be for war orphans, right? And it was supposed to be sort of connected. So if you're connected to a military family and you were orphan, you would get a position in one of these schools, right, for young sailors or young officers. Those are the uniforms they're in. Those are boarding schools, right? Those are kids that are under supervision. They're, you know, being drilled every day. They're being trained to prosecute war. The girl on the left, is watching the younger children. Super gendered, you know, sort of roles of what would happen. Yeah, so there's a little boy and a little girl, and that's what's hard to see. He's holding an airplane. Airplane is like Soviet talk for technology and, you know, progress, right? That's science. He's holding science in his hand. She's got a little, like a little hoop stick thing that she's playing a game with, right? These are safe children. Right? They're controlled children. They're, you know, sort of doing what they're supposed to do. I don't know. There's a lot to think about. You know, is there an attempt here to show what I, for my purposes, when I was looking at this, when I was writing the book, I was trying to make the point that their children actually made a lot of contributions to the war effort that actually went sort of unnoticed because of the overwhelming sort of sense of victimization of children, which happened, but children also were a sort of vital part of the war as well. And this doesn't do anything to help them, right? These are receivers of the victory. They aren't participants in the victory. They just are the recipients, right? The sort of beneficiaries of other people's sacrifice. I mean, they don't even look like they've sacrificed much.
Well, it's like they're being restored to childhood.
Yes,
yeah.
And that I can understand, right? The war restores a childhood, except it didn't,
right?
And I don't know. Just it really plays with, and the fact that it's the Blockade Siege Survivors Association that steps in.
Say more about that.
They all look dead.
That's just fascinating to me. I couldn't actually find very much more about that story. But that was the group that came in and said, we don't want this image. This is not the image we want to think of. Now, there is another memorial in the same cemetery. This is a big cemetery in St. Petersburg that's got a lot of memorials to the war in it. There is another one that's just to the children of the blockade, and it's a little girl wrapped up in a shawl. I don't know. I don't think, when I was looking at the photographs the first time I was looking at this, I don't think it's the first guy's sculpture. Might be, I don't know, but it's just sort of a concrete, almost like a teardrop, and she's standing sort of on it, right? And it's to the children of the blockade.
how triumphal, again, not in the sense of Soviet triumphalism, but in the sense of Putin triumphalism, right? I mean, how much are we sort of retelling the story of the war as something happy? I don't know. Yeah. Just interesting to think about. Yeah.
So I'm curious about the timing of the memorials of the ones that you didn't show, the ones that were to the specific child heroes, you know, the heroines, you know. And I think who's that girl who was executed brutally and they immediately made a film about her?
Zoya Kuzmetynianska.
Yeah. And,
yes.
And a gazillion more like that.
Yes.
So were those, did those pop up like right after the war? Basically, that's just my question. It's like,
yeah.
did you see those more immediately and then these sort of general, you know, all kids later, like in post Soviet?
Yeah. So I think it's easier to put up a monument to an individual hero than it is to think about how to encapsulate the experience of a group, right? And so when you have a kid who maybe is from your hometown, who everybody said, even if he didn't do it or she didn't do it, everybody said did this heroic thing, that's pretty easy to put up a bronze face and a thing and put flowers on it once a year and take all the school kids to it and say, yay, for, you know, I don't know, Matrosa, right, or somebody. Zoya, right, is all over the place. She's a huge hero, right? Last time I was at the children's library, the librarian said, oh, Zoya, that story still makes me cry. I mean, right? I mean, these are living stories, right? And so I think those pop up quicker and more often because they're easy, in a sense, to deal with, right? As opposed to these group memorials, which I think are a lot harder. And they're so few. To me, that's really interesting that there's just so few.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was also curious about, this timing of different kinds of public commemorations like this. And just because everywhere else I know about, there are all these fights all the time over this. And so are you saying that's been not an issue? I mean, at one point it sounded like you're saying this is something everybody can agree on, so they just do the memorials about the public, because they can all agree that was, you know, or there, what are the other kind of fissures that might be avoided by not doing? Because everywhere, I mean, again, everywhere else I'm talking about, in Europe,
yeah,
you know, there are just fights constantly. And
yes,
they just keep going. Even now that the living memory is gone, there's still fights on, you know, Memorial Day.
I definitely wasn't meaning to suggest that any of the discussions about those previous memorials were simple in any way.
But victim group, for example, you said who counted the victim? Like what? Are there fights like that?
Oh, yes. And
okay.
So who counts as a war participant? Because if you're counted as a war participant, there's actually pension attached to that, right? There's housing that's attached to that. And so the idea of, and the way that I understand it is that actually the first time that they came up and proposed, okay, if you were a child during the war, you are going to be categorized as, it's not a veteran, but it was sort of the next category.
Mm-hmm.
They actually, there was a whole group that came forward and turned it down. Said, we don't want that. We don't want to be counted as that, which I find fascinating, right? Later, the discussion is, no, we want to be counted as this.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's very, very contested and very complicated. Veterans don't get their entitlements for years and years and years after the war. And so that is very complicated. That was a great meaning.
Well, collaboration. I mean, you
know,
that always comes in other places.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that we have been traumatized, horrified, and